Hello and welcome to A Healthy Mind. I'm Dr. Sislena Grocer Ledbetter, Director of Counseling and Student Development at the University of the District of Columbia, and your host. In a previous show on anxiety and children, we had a guest, a special guest, Dr. Bonnie Zucker. She shared with us that 6 to 20% of all children between the ages of 6 and 17 meet the criteria for an anxiety disorder. Because of that high statistic, and because I love her so much now, we decided to bring Dr. Zucker back to do a part two on anxiety and children, to talk about strategies that parents can use to support their children diagnosed with anxiety disorder. Dr. Bonnie Zucker is a licensed psychologist with expertise in cognitive behavioral psychotherapy, CBT, with children, adolescents, and adults. She received her doctoral degree from Illinois School of Professional Psychology in Chicago, and her master's degree in applied psychology from the University of Baltimore. Dr. Zucker is the author of Anxiety-Free Kids, an interactive guide for parents and children, a self-help book for children with anxiety disorders and their parents, and Take Control of OCD, the ultimate guide for kids with OCD. Dr. Zucker was named one of Washingtonian magazine's top therapists in the field of cognitive behavioral therapy, OCD, Phobias, Trouble Child, and Trouble Adolescent, in 2009. Welcome, Dr. Zucker. And you're here talking to me.
Thank you.
Yes.
Thank you for having me back.
Yeah, I'm so excited to have you back because anxiety and children's anxiety is huge.
Yes.
And as parents and as administrators of schools, we are so interested in trying to figure out how to deal with the overexposure and the over, it seems, stimulation
right.
of our children
yes.
and anxiety. So I wanted you to talk a little bit more about the exposure that the children have to things like media
yes.
and the other things that might cause anxiety. For example, I won't buy my kid. There's a game out called like Black Cops or mm-hmm. Black Ops or whatever.
Yeah.
I don't know if I can say that, but
right.
I just did.
Right, right.
And it's something that I won't buy because I believe it creates anxiety. So talk about the role of media. And
absolutely. And technology. I mean, it's fascinating because our conversation today is so different than it was 30 years ago.
Mm-hmm.
You know, now you've got the internet all over the place. We carry it around with us in our pockets and our purses. You know, kids start to get cell phones usually in middle school or by the end of middle school and then in high school, and next thing you know, they've got the smartphones. And so, and it's really important to create healthy boundaries with technology and screens in general.
So let's pause there
yes,
for a second.
Yes.
Because you said healthy boundaries.
Healthy boundaries.
And I don't think that giving me some parameters about what you define as a healthy
yes,
barrier to
right.
share would
absolutely.
Be great.
Absolutely, and sometimes parents need to learn those boundaries themselves.
Yeah.
So, you know, when you're with your children, try to not look at your phone the whole time, right? When you're at dinner, don't have phones on the table. When a
That's
child
so great.
Receives a cell phone, with it comes the rule of use of this phone is not allowed after 8 o'clock or 9 o'clock at night, and the phone needs to be charged in a common area like the kitchen.
Oh, that's great.
Because the problem is that kids have them by their bed, and they're texting and looking on the internet and reading things,
oh,
and
God.
You know, and there's then yeah. you really can't protect your kids from stuff.
And buy a real alarm clock. Your phone does not have to
clock.
Be your
right.
alarm clock.
What did we do without phones?
That's
you
right.
Know?
It doesn't have to have my alarm clock.
Right. And so, and kids today, not only are they exposed to so much more with the
mm-hmm.
with phones
mm-hmm.
and the internet, but the frequency at which information is coming at them is so much more. Then we can't understand it because when we were children, we didn't have this.
Yeah.
So what we need to do now is we need to be very thoughtful about teaching kids early on the purpose of relaxation, the importance of taking time out to clear their mind. This needs to be incorporated as a daily skill, just like we take time to eat and sleep
mm-hmm.
and do homework. We also have to have relaxation time, screen-free time. It's very important for kids to be in nature. There's even parts and centers of your brain that don't develop when you're not in nature. And it's so important to get kids outdoors, to go for walks.
That's great.
You know, and I've been amazed, families who are so overscheduled, they can hardly fit in my...
Stop talking about me, Bonnie. Stop
right.
it.
I know. It's just, this is for you. Forget about
That's
her.
That's right. Forget about
her. But it's like, you know, it's so busy.
Yes.
And computers, of course, were developed to create more efficient work
yes.
in less time.
Yes.
And
that
I say that was a flop.
That's right.
You know, and
failed experiment.
Failed experiment. And, you know, but for kids and their families, when they're so overscheduled, and mm-hmm. I say, can you guys take a 15-minute walk at night? the families that actually do that, no phones are allowed on the walk, have a very different experience because there's a blissful experience when you're with your kids or you're with your partner and you're not in the rush of things. And our bodies are not designed to go.
And I think that in this generation where everything is so accessible, we used to go to the library. What about the card catalog? Haven't heard that phrase in a while.
I love that word.
Yeah, so the card catalog. The
term.
Yeah, you got to go to the library.
Right, right.
So because they don't have that anymore, and it really is not their reality, I don't know that particularly children can connect with how much anxiety having that exposure 24/7 creating in their bodies.
Absolutely. And I think they become less tuned into their bodies. And, I always say one of the best things that ever happened to me was when my back went out 8 years ago, because 3 weeks later I began a practice of yoga, which I've continued to do regularly for 8 years. Wow. I teach kids, I'm not a certified yoga teacher, but I show them a couple of moves, restorative yoga positions. And the kids that do, they love it.
Really?
And, I'll set them up in even something as simple as putting them against the wall with their legs up the wall. So sort of their rear is against the wall and the legs just go up. It's this very cooling.
I like that.
And I say, just stay there for 10 minutes,
My goodness.
And what happens is the kids then get into their bodies. It's sort of like, at night as adults, you lie in your bed and suddenly you realize how tired your body is or how your body feels or maybe some part hurts or something like that.
Yeah.
And it's been that way all day. It's just that you're tuning into it.
Right.
And we really call that's a form of mindfulness. So mindfulness is when you're aware and you want to be aware of your body. Mm-hmm. You want to be aware of the senses, the smells, the visuals, what you hear. Mm-hmm. And when kids are like honing in on a world phone, it's like they're shutting out everything out. And then their body is becoming programmed to be, it's almost like a hypervigilance sometimes.
Yeah.
Even the constant like bzz, bzz, you're always.
Too much.
Right. And so kids need to learn that, first of all, you can't prevent them from being on the phone.
Seriously.
Okay. It doesn't work. Okay. Because then you're doing them a disservice. The texting is the way they communicate.
They do.
If you prevent your child from texting, you're basically isolating them from their
peers. Okay.
The goal is to teach portion control.
Right.
So like these are the hours. And by the way, during the weekend, you need to have a block of time where you're not on your phone.
Yeah.
And kids are going to protest, but you have to literally take it from them. And I think that for the anxious child in particular and the anxious teenager, they're already entering into situations overstimulated, but then they have to deal with the constant, information coming upon them.
Yeah.
And so I think it's really important to teach kids these relaxation skills and these boundaries. And I also think for kids who have social anxiety, for example, they can misread a lot of these text messages and emails. So they can start feeling, social anxiety is different from shyness.
Okay.
Even though it might look the same sometimes, but with someone it's actually social phobia is the diagnosis. So someone with social phobia worries about being judged negatively in social situations.
Got it.
They take more responsibility for negative outcomes in social situations than they should.
So it's always about me. This is me.
What did I do? Why are they laughing at me?
Yeah.
I hear all the kids talking about
me.
So and so's mom doesn't like
me.
You start to hear all these comments.
Yes.
And they will oftentimes avoid, and then they'll read something that could be construed in a negative light and they'll say, so and so's mad at me.
Right.
So now you have to deal with the social anxiety and the world of technology.
But
what you're trying to do is, and this is a good time for me to introduce thinking errors, because the kids with social anxiety, they use a lot of what's called mind reading and personalization. And mind reading is basically jumping to conclusions about what other people are saying about you.
Right.
So they think I'm stupid. They think I'm a loser.
Right.
They think I'm this or whatever. And then personalization is taking more responsibility for a negative outcome.
Mm-hmm.
So someone's looking at me, maybe I offended them.
So how do you stop, as a parent, how do you stop them? It's like nobody's
mad at you.
Right.
And two things. One, you have to say, I was watching UDC-TV, and they were talking about these thing called thinking errors.
Right.
One example of that's catastrophizing, what-if thinking.
Mm-hmm.
You visualize disaster, and then you think you can't handle it. So what if this happens? What if disaster strikes?
Mm-hmm.
And someone who's catastrophizing is going to think like that a lot. Well, there's another one called personalization, which is where you make things about you when there are other factors that are better, to explain the situation.
Right.
And, what would someone without social anxiety think? What is someone who's socially confident think in this situation? What's someone with good self-esteem thinking?
So you ask the child that.
I ask them.
Okay.
Do you have a friend who doesn't worry about these things? Well, yeah, my friend so-and-so. She never seems to care what others think.
Okay.
I'm like, okay, what would she think in this situation?
I see.
You know, and
so you're linking. That's not the right concept.
Yeah, yeah. No, but you are. You're making a connection and a pairing of this positive thought with this, or this neutral thought that's more reality-based and not distorted.
Yes.
And, you know, what you want to teach kids to say, oh, there I go again, personalizing.
Oh, yes.
Oh, there I go again, mind reading.
Right.
I'm always, this is the same trend for me. I keep thinking other people are judging me.
Right.
Negatively.
Right. You want to say it in a non-pejorative way. You don't want to make the student.
Right.
You don't want to make the child feel judged because you're calling out a behavior. So you have to kind of come to them in a very calm way, like,
you do.
You know.
Yes, and you know.
You need deep breathing.
You're right. And CBT, cognitive behavioral therapy, can sometimes seem a little invalidating because I'm basically saying, hey, your thoughts that seem totally normal to you, they're errors. Those are thinking errors. Those are cognitive distortions. So you have to say it in a really gentle way, and you have to say something like, you know, everyone makes thinking errors. I can be an all or nothing thinker. I can be a perfectionist. I want things to be like this, and if they're not, I have this really bad feeling like it's wrong.
Okay, okay.
And so I'm always challenging myself to say, that's all or nothing thinking.
Right, right.
What would a flexible person think in this situation?
You're flexible.
You know, right, exactly. You might think but I'm always challenging myself to become more. And when you can be a human to kids, and you could say, you know, I make thinking errors, everyone makes something.
Right.
Your thinking error happens to be personalization.
Right.
And I would really like it for you to feel more confident in these situations that are social.
And I think you point out something that is important, and that is being human in front of your kids, because so many parents don't like to feel exposed or open.
Right.
Oh my gosh, I've never experienced anxiety, so how can my kids? You just got to be transparent.
You
just got to let the kid be who the kid is and meet them where they are.
Yes.
And let them know that you've been afraid too at times, and you know, you just can't be here.
Right. No, exactly. Yeah. And I mean, you can still be a parent to your parent and still have authority with your parent, with your child, but still let your child have intimacy with you.
Right.
Where they could feel like they know you.
Right.
And you could say, you know, I struggle with this sometimes.
Yeah.
And you know what? I probably personalize
that's
at times
so
and let's work together, you know, to overcome this. But what you want to do with the exposure is you want to find out what are the behaviors that, example, a kid with social anxiety are avoiding. So these kids sometimes will avoid being the center of center of attention. They won't express their preferences. So their friends might say, well, what do you want to eat? And they'll say, I don't know, wherever you want to go. You know, I know of one one client who saw a movie twice because she didn't want to say she had seen it.
Are you kidding me?
Yeah.
This was an adult, right?
Yes.
Okay.
But the point is it sort of gives, I'm afraid to express my preferences.
Right.
I'm afraid to tell someone that I'm upset with them, and I'm so afraid that they're going to be upset with me.
Yeah, and the point, we laughed about it, but I think the point that I was making is if you don't do an intervention and you don't really work with the child on their anxiety, they become adults.
They become this way, right. So it's not like a lot of allergies you outgrow.
Right.
There is a very strong relationship between childhood and adulthood anxiety. So if you, and that's why I love working with kids, because there's a preventative component. If I can get them to see that facing your fears is the way to go and have them do it, it sets up this whole thing that in the future when there's fears, like even recently I was contacted by someone I worked with about 8 years ago, and she said, I know I'm supposed to be facing my fears on this. And I was like, This is such a great moment because this stuck with you.
Yeah.
You know, and I think it's really important to see the behaviors that they're avoiding, how the family, in a very loving way, is actually accommodating the anxiety. You get this a lot of the time.
Mm-hmm.
Like I have this, I worked with this child who didn't like to be in the room alone. So she wouldn't want to be in the living room if she was alone, or the basement if she was alone. And she wanted to have someone in the room with her. So her family members learned to sing when they were in different rooms. So they would literally be in the kitchen. I'm in the kitchen now making a snack and I'll be back
Seriously?
In a minute. You know, yes. And what the child was then experiencing was I'm connected to my family member and the other. I'm not alone.
Okay.
Okay, because that helped the parent in this case to go into the kitchen without the kid following.
Okay.
But what it was really doing was unintentionally reinforcing, like by without the intention to do it, they were making the anxiety worse.
I'm thinking. Yeah.
Because but parents sometimes get in this trap where their kid is struggling so much to do something that they encourage the avoidance because it's hard for them to experience the distress in their child.
Right.
So, you know, I think it's very loving, and I only really meet loving, warm parents who want the best for their kids. Mm-hmm. The problem is that sometimes they end up being accommodating and over empathizing and not having as much sort of demand on their child to face their fears.
So this kid is alone and doesn't like to be alone.
Right.
And you're a parent and you're in another room.
Right.
How do you get this kid to to understand that you can be alone? What do you do?
You
is it desensitization?
It's
you're
desensitization,
alone?
Right. So we're going to start with, you're going to be here and I'm going to give you a little puzzle.
Right.
And when you're done with the puzzle, call me and I'm going to come back in.
Right. Right.
During that time, you're probably going to feel anxious, and what I want you to do is I want you to experience the anxiety and not react to it.
Okay,
I'm
facing
anxious,
your fear.
Facing my fears. I'm sitting there anxious. I want them to get desensitized to the emotional experience of anxiety.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm sitting here in the room alone. I feel really scared. All I want is for my mom to come back in the room. I'm feeling really nervous. She told me to do this puzzle. I'm feeling nervous in my body. Here I feel it in my stomach. You know, I feel my chest is tight. Okay, I remember all I'm supposed to do is just notice how I feel and endure the discomfort.
Mm-hmm.
And then guess what happens? After the puzzle, we do it again.
Oh.
We do it again.
Okay.
We do it for longer. We do it for 7 minutes. We do it for 10 minutes. We do it up to a 30-minute TV program.
Mm-hmm.
And we get the child to become used to gradually being alone. Over time, they've had the experience where they've been alone and they've been fine, and they learn how to tolerate the strong emotions, and the next thing you know, they're not anxious in the situation.
And so they may be anxious for a reason. So they may be born with the propensity,
absolutely,
the predisposition to have anxiety,
yes,
or
right.
They may be traumatized.
Correct.
Something may have happened.
That's right.
That says, when I'm alone, this person hurts me.
That's right. And in that case, we're leaving the realm of anxiety disorders, and we're now talking about trauma, which is perfectly fine, because a lot of times the child looks anxious, but the anxiety is a symptom of the trauma, as opposed to the anxiety being a symptom of an anxiety disorder. So a kid with a dog phobia or separation anxiety about being in the rooms, that is the problem.
Right.
You know, with a child who's afraid to be alone because it resembles the trauma or reminds them of the trauma, that's now trauma-based work.
Right.
And a lot of kids are traumatized and they don't talk about it.
And they create, potentially it can mimic that anxiety
disorder. It can mimic that anxiety because they were alone when that bad trauma happened to them. Right. And so for trauma, that's really when you have to intervene with treatment.
Okay.
Okay, and the research is really clear that prolonged exposure, believe it or not, that word again, exposure, like facing your fears in a way, is the way to go with trauma.
Tell me what that means.
Yeah. So
what is prolonged exposure?
We make a tape recording for about 30 to 45 minutes in length of the trauma with as many details as they can recall. They listen to it repeatedly. Nobody likes this.
Nobody likes this.
And I have total success with it.
So I know.
But what's happening is you're sitting down and you're hearing your story and it becomes reprocessed.
I gotcha.
There's also a lot of good work about EMDR, eye movement reprocessing and desensitization.
Yeah, I want you to talk about that,
yeah.
But I want you to tell me how you do that if the parent has now been exposed or the child has now said, this happened to me.
Right. So, there's a reporting liability. So, you know, like in the event that, so obviously that if a child has been abused, there needs to be a report made for
right,
that.
Okay. Right.
So this way the child, there's a safety plan.
Right.
So the child doesn't have continued abuse.
Right.
And that whoever abused them is not going on to abuse other people. So
right.
the purpose of that is to protect children.
Right.
Once we have them in a safe situation, then the therapy work can take place.
Okay.
Okay. So then the thing is, parents can provide what I call a holding environment. You know, or it's in the literature, a holding environment for your child. So
okay.
I can be a container for your very big feelings. You can express to me all the really scary things that have happened to you, all the ways you feel about it, and I can hold that with you. This is really, really valuable.
Yeah.
The other thing is we're going to take some action around it because you have to take action. So you can't just have a trauma and not take action. You have to find a way to work on the trauma and take action,
and the taboo, especially in a lot of cultures, Black people for sure.
Yes.
They don't like to talk about trauma and how it impacts the family and Uncle Bobo and Juju.
Right.
You know, I don't want to talk about it. Why are you bringing it up?
Right.
So once you bring it up,
Right.
I think your point is you have to hold it. You have to validate the kid.
Yes.
You got to validate the
children.
Right.
This shouldn't have happened to you. This was wrong.
Right.
Adults should not act this way.
And ignoring it doesn't help.
Ignoring it doesn't do anything. In fact, that is, it's unresolved trauma that leads to all these problems, you know? And if we had a really amazing society, I always think if I could intervene with the education system, I think it's fantastic to learn about math and science and social studies and history and blah, blah, blah.
Yeah.
Art, great.
Yeah.
Okay, but why isn't there a class on feelings and emotions and stress and why aren't, you know, why isn't that class designed to help kids understand what healthy boundaries are with your body, what it means to have a trauma, how to communicate that you've been traumatized.
Oh my goodness, that would be huge.
How to manage your stress, everyone feels it, you know, and so the issue is we rely on parents.
Yeah.
Parents are the ones that if we can train parents, and it would be great for schools, you know,
yeah,
and I work with a lot of schools.
Good, and I want you to talk about that, because I would submit that
the lack of that
is what we're seeing now.
Yes, right.
That children are really
yes.
just kind of spiraling in this emotional social abyss. They don't really know what to do with
That's right.
They don't even know what real connection is.
Right.
It's like, hang that phone up, stop tweeting that young lady, and call
right.
her.
Right, exactly.
What?
Right. And you know, if you call, that's like you're weird.
You know, it's like, what do you mean?
Right,
I'm texting. So.
Right. Yeah, and at schools, you know, if you can get a school counselor or a homeroom teacher to say, we're gonna have 5 minutes of relaxation, or I'm gonna create a lunch bunch meeting, and in my meeting, we're gonna listen to a 10-minute relaxation exercise.
Yeah. I'm trying to be in that class.
Yeah, right, exactly. I wanna go to the class.
I wanna go to that class.
I'm coming with you. You know, it's like, you know, go stop by, you know, for 10 minutes and then go eat your lunch, or eat your lunch and then come by for 10 minutes.
Right,
and,
right.
You know, I'm gonna do it in groups of 10 kids, and, you know, I'll be here the whole lunch. You know,
and it's
for
too
you.
Bad because it's looked at as soft and cheeky.
Right, exactly.
And
you know,
truth is, this is real life stuff
this
that
is
saves
like,
children's lives.
It does.
And administrators
really,
need to take note.
They do. And if we can look at how we can improve communication on this topic, both at home and at school, I think you're going to see a lot more resiliency in kids.
And what have you done with schools? And what has been receptive?
Right. Like, so I go to school. I'm hired quite often by schools. I probably give 8 to 10 talks a year at schools where I go to, there's usually like a parent meeting that I'll come to. And sometimes there's 20 parents and sometimes there's 100 parents. I mean, it depends what kind of school. You know, I've gone to some private schools that are, you know, K through 8th.
Sure.
It's a big parent base. And, you know, and what's great is the school counselors there will say, hey, we're going to start doing 5 minutes of 2 yoga positions.
Wow.
Or we're going to offer for you a little progressive muscle relaxation.
Now,
so they start
after your session?
After I've talked,
Are the administrators in there?
Yes, they are.
Are
and
they?
They're on board, yes.
That's
so
good.
It's, you know, and but we need it. It can't just be private schools. That's
no,
a little tiny
can't.
Percentage. It needs to be public
schools.
But you're
available
schools.
To public schools.
I can go to any public school. Absolutely. I want to go around
you
to
gotta,
everyone.
Yeah.
And I want to say, you know, hey, by the way, there are a lot of kids there that are sitting in your classroom and they're anxious. And they're just going to be this way. And to me, anxiety is suffering, and it's the opposite of freedom. So when you're not, when you have anxiety and you're worried, you're not free. And you know, one thing we haven't talked about is sort of the developmental stages that kids are at.
That'd be
you
cool.
know, and
yeah, yes.
and you want to think about like, for example, if something happens to like a 3-year-old or a 4-year-old, they're at the stage of autonomy. This is Eric Erickson's work on the 8 stages of man, which I'm sure you're familiar. You know, it's autonomy versus shame and doubt.
Right,
so if something
right.
happens to them and they're not given the autonomy, then they have this sense of guilt that they sort of carry around that comes out of shame.
And sometimes it doesn't come out in a big way. Sometimes it comes out in a way that looks very withdrawn.
Exactly. And that's important. And school age kids, you know, 6 through 12 are in what he calls the industry versus inferiority stage. Which is when I think it's really important if you have anxiety to treat it.
Yeah.
Because
what are those ages again?
Yeah, so that's 6 to 12.
6 to 12.
Industry versus inferiority.
Yep.
Industry is a sense of industriousness, capability, I can do it.
Mm-hmm.
Inferiority is the opposite of that. So if everyone can go to the sleepover, but I'm too scared to sleep out, I'm gonna develop a sense of inferiority.
Right.
You know,
right.
in fact, that's that snake phobia I talked to you about.
Yeah.
So, you know, we in the last episode, we went to the zoo. We went to Petco, and at Petco, we had the person take out a little snake.
A little
A little like you know, black garden snake, and we sat, you know, stood like within a foot, and that was the top of his ladder.
Yeah.
And you know, I ran into his parents like a year after that or something in a bookstore, and I said, "How's your son doing?" And they said, "You know what? He was we would have told you he's the most confident kid in the world. After he overcame his snake phobia, he was even more confident. Like, we just saw a change.
Isn't that something?
It's amazing. And so, you know, when you have anxiety, you've got self-doubt.
And what I think you just said was it really suppresses other things.
It does.
It's like
absolutely.
You think you just got an anxiety about snake, and you've internalized that thing, and you got an anxiety about a whole bunch of stuff.
A whole bunch of stuff.
Yeah, yeah.
And when I should be interacting socially with my peers, I'm sitting here instead thinking about what's that rustling in the leaves? Mm-hmm. And how does that interact with, like, how does that interfere with my play and my connection with others?
Right.
You know, so what we have to do is, it's interesting. At the same time, I want parents to be worried and concerned about anxiety, but I also want them to be completely assured that there's a solid treatment approach that can get you out of this whole realm of anxiety disorders.
Right,
And I think, you know, the treatment can start at home, but at a point, if you're not able to make progress, that's when you need to get a professional.
Right.
Lots of people try to go the medication route. I think there's a great place for medication. I don't think it's the starting place.
It shouldn't be.
It should not
be. And you don't let the teachers prescribe medication.
This is correct. Right. I know. And you do. And you get a lot of well-intentioned teachers say, I think it's ADHD.
Yeah.
You know, why don't you
they
put them on
well.
Stimulant
right.
med? They mean, they're well-intentioned.
Right.
No, but they,
you're
but
right.
sometimes they're not. Sometimes
you're right,
they just
right.
want that kid to stop.
Yeah.
Right. But you know what? Sometimes someone looks like they have ADHD, but they actually have generalized anxiety disorder. Mm-hmm. Because generalized anxiety disorder, it's 6 months or more of chronic worrying, accompanied by difficulty concentrating or mind going blank, muscle tension, restlessness. Okay, so that restlessness and that difficulty concentrating resembles an attention issue.
Wow, you know? Have 20 seconds.
Yeah, so, oh gosh. So,
and I want you to leave with a parting thought.
Yes, you know, I think the thing is if you can get into your child's mind as much as possible, if you can create the environment where your kids are free to tell you anything and everything that they think about or experience, you have just protected them, and you have fostered resiliency.
You are
There's
fantastic.
There's no question.
I love you.
Thank you. I love you.
If you are, if you have additional questions or concerns about your children's anxiety or anxiety disorders, consider contacting Dr. Zucker at www.bonniezucker.com. If you'd like to reach me, you can visit me on Facebook at Twitter, Facebook or Twitter at Dr. Sis. I'm Dr. Sislena Grocer Ledbetter. Thank you for watching. I'll see you next time on A Healthy Mind.